On the 5th of August, the Bank of England announced by surprise their grim forecast for the UK, predicting not only that the country would fall into recession, but expecting this one to last until at least end 2023. This represents one of the most pessimistic forecasts of economic outlook given by the Bank of England during the last 50 years. The situation has gotten so dire that today, 28th of September, the Bank of England announced the purchase of £5 billion today in long-term bonds to cap the exponential rise in government debt interests. The UK has been in turmoil for a while now. The COVID-19 pandemic wreaked havoc in the island's economy, and by end 2020, the Brexit process effectively led to the detachment from the European Union, creating a nationwide shortage of workers, especially in highly qualified jobs and transportation sectors. Since then, the situation slightly improved, and the UK experienced a sharp rebound of 7.4% in its GDP, higher than many of its peers, while other leading indicators led to a continuation of this positive trend. Even when almost all growth projections got trimmed by the start of the war in Ukraine and global oil and gas supply shocks, that didn't trigger the alarms in the UK. In contrast to Germany and Eastern European countries, the UK is relying on Norway for energy supply, with most of its consumption coming from domestic production of oil and gas, while the relationship with Russia is very residual for oil and gas trade. But this has not been enough for the country to avoid experiencing decades-high levels of inflation and pushing the Bank of England to anticipate an increase beyond 13% growth in annual inflation rates for the near future. The UK is one of the most complex economies and a G10 member, but the current volatility of data suggests underlying factors may be more problematic than anticipated, forcing Britain to act upon them if it wants to resume its positive growth trend of around 2.5% per year and eliminate the financial fragility which is being witnessed in UK markets. Today, we'll give an overview of the economy of the United Kingdom and shed some light on what are the main issues derailing the progress of what once was the largest empire the world has ever seen, and how has it been possible to see in 2022 the pound sterling losing 20% of its value with no end in sight for the nightmare of the unstoppable currency depreciation. It was in the UK where the Industrial Revolution started. Generally, those who innovate first manage to develop a monopoly or competitive advantage in the field of innovation, if those new inputs happen to find a growing, addressable market. In Great Britain, the explosion of economic growth, from the numerous technological advances brought in by inventions like the steam engine, the railway, or the establishments of factories, and blended with the geographical extension of the empire, consolidated into a competitive advantage in three fields: trade, textile, and manufacturing. The city of Manchester became the first industrial center on earth and the world's trade center of textiles and cotton, reasons why the city eventually got the nickname of Cottonopolis. The early adoption of industrial towns and the creation of the working class propelled the productivity rate and growth in manufacturing. British factories became the most efficient manufacturing centers in the planet, with little competition in sight. Finally, the large extension of the empire, with colonies embedded in some of the most commodity-rich countries in Asia and Africa, combined with being the first nation adopting coal as main source of energy, turned the UK, and especially London, into the main global trading hub. While during the 19th century the UK enjoyed the privileges of their competitive advantages, those were eventually lost to other nations, more specifically the United States. The US didn't fall behind in innovation rates and capital intensity. While the UK was the nation igniting the start of the first industrial revolution and setting the basis of capitalism, it was the US who led the way for the second industrial revolution and became the most prominent representation of this economic philosophy. But even before that, the advantages of the extensive land within the states and its favorable business environments helped the American nation surpass the UK in production of coal and cotton. The loss of the pound as reserve currency, overtaken by the US dollar, and as a result of the US being the only unscathed industrial nation after World War II, with an intact industrial powerhouse, pushed Britain to start restructuring itself by mid-20th century, when the grip on overseas colonies started to fade and London started to lose ground to New York as the new capital center of the world. Don't get me wrong, the UK has always been one of the most advanced nations with well-diversified industries and favorable business environments. London still leads today as the world's most remarkable trade center. It is the largest foreign exchange market in daily volume of trade, home to 37% of all financial professionals in the world, and the city also houses the London Bullion Market, the biggest market in the world for trading gold and silver. What's interesting here though is how the UK economy changed since its colonial bust post-World War II, And how has the economy been left so vulnerable today? The evolution of the UK's GDP components speak about the transformations which have been taking place, proving the island has not been immune to globalization trends and outsourcing of labor to mainly Asian countries. Manufacturing in the UK underwent the process of outsourcing cheap manufacturers while keeping high value-added ones. Yet, this change didn't really help much some historically important industries like the automotive sector. The growth in car production peaked by the end of the 90s, and by 2021, given the supply chain bottlenecks and decreased investments in fabrication efforts inside the islands, the number of cars produced equaled the output of 1956. While firms like Land Rover and Bentley have been bought out by foreign firms, they continue to produce high-end vehicles inside the UK, together with the famous Aston Martin brand. While cars are not delivering what they used to the economy, the financial sector continues to be the backbone of the British economy. British banks and trustees have been famous for using the remaining colony islands overseas to raise capital, generally coming from shady clients, and funnel it into the City of London. Russian oligarchs, Mexican drug cartels, politicians and powerful personalities who earned money from shady businesses or just stole it from the public treasuries and wanted to hide it for tax or safety purposes used this scheme to wash their cash to later pour it into British assets. The deregulation of finance in the country promoted by Margaret Thatcher in the 80s and the deeply rooted financial culture helped the banking sector stay competitive in international trade business. While the UK lost its empire, it gained the Commonwealth, an exclusive alliance between former colonies, facilitating movement of people between members and promoting development and equality projects. While the only trade agreement between member countries came between the UK and Australia by end 2021, the close relationships between participants have proven to be successful in maintaining the presence of British enterprises in former colonized regions. But back to sectorial productivity, this is very unequally distributed. Despite London being the second financial capital of the world only after New York, in the last study by the World Bank in 2018, the United Kingdom appears the 18th ranked as the country with highest net national income per capita, while other countries also housing a strong financial industry rank among the top 5 highest earners. Hence, financial markets and wealth management doesn't seem to be enough to boost income per capita, at least when compared to the expensive cost of living, with London appearing at the top of the list. This year so far has not been a good year for any kind of investor, except for those who did the exact opposite to what Mr. Ray Dalio believed should have been done, and stayed in cash. More specifically, the US dollar. The US dollar index is at a 20-year high, and while this may seem at a glance like very beneficial for the US, it's actually not that good for anybody. Today, we are no longer on the gold standard. There is a gold market, but unlike in the past when gold was meant to be a hedge for inflation or currency devaluation, today currencies appreciate or depreciate against each other. These movements are purely driven by market forces, and then there is an intervention by the central bank, but we'll go on to that later. For now, let's stick to market forces. Even without the gold standards, the role of currency has not changed much from the past. Money is basically debt. While before that debt could be collected in the form of grams of gold, today national debts are purely a means to claim goods and services from the issuing nation, or exchange it for goods and services into another currency from a different issuing nation. The value of a currency is equal to the value of exports minus the value of foreign denominated currency imports. From this equation, we can understand that when a currency loses value, as it is happening now in the UK, at an alarming rate, in essence, this means the value of the goods and services provided by the UK to the world are losing attractive or demand, while the UK demands more services and goods from the world. Another reason explaining this fragile situation comes from a dangerous policy being conducted from Downing Street. When the UK placed a cap of £2,500 a year on energy bills to households, the increases in energy prices were immediately transferred to the state treasury, as there is no such a thing as a free lunch. Somebody always needs to pay the bill. With inflation at multi-decade high, the Bank of England raising rates at the highest speed on record, and the new Prime Minister announcing the biggest tax cut plan since the times of Margaret Thatcher, the accounting book of the UK government is at serious risk of breaking down, because long story short, the numbers just don't add up. While cutting taxes is a positive measure to promote growth in the private sector, and so is decreasing energy costs to households, the market is aware that the government is pursuing a contradictory plan. Financing spending with lower revenue, leaving only the path of more debt issuance as the only alternative to finance its plans, while the UK debt levels are already at an all-time high. The problem is, we don't know how expensive energy bills can get. Hence, the market is betting short the UK government is running out of time and money. That's not true in nominal terms. The Bank of England can print money which the government can later spend, action known as monetization of debt. The problem comes from the value of that same money. When you are injecting new banknotes into the financial blood vessels, rather than using the already outstanding supply, by levying more taxes on citizens. The strategy is hence contradictory. This ends up brewing a conflict between the Bank of England and the government. With the strongest US dollar in two decades and weakest pound in 50 years, and almost every country except Japan lifting rates and cutting liquidity like there's no tomorrow, this is clearly not the time to spend money. And added to the view from market participants about the declining utility of your goods and services, the UK must immediately reverse course in order to avoid a second George Soros scenario. George Soros, at least in 1991, wasn't more evil than any other investment banker or trader in the city. But he was really good at math. Today the situation is unlike the one back then, which was triggered by the Bank of England running out of reserves to defend the pound's fixed exchange rate with foreign currencies. But the mathematic paradigm is just as similar. Has the UK enough money to pay its debts? Or maybe even easier to understand. Is the world willing to keep accepting more pounds for the same goods and services as before? Or will economic agents demand more pounds for the same goods and services? Nevertheless, remember the power when I mentioned the currency market may be influenced also by a central bank intervention? Well, that's exactly what happened today. The Bank of England has been forced to step in to buy bonds at a pace of £5 billion per day for a couple of weeks. But a couple of weeks ago, it was the Bank of Japan who had to intervene in markets for the first time since 1999 to halt a violent depreciation spiral moving the yen to multi-decade lows. When a central bank steps in markets like the Bank of England did today, they create artificial demand for the currency by purchasing it in the form of forex reserves or bonds from other market agents. Their goal is to make their currency appreciate in value against other foreign currencies, but they run the risk of depleting their own foreign reserves, like it happened in 1991. Taking an overview of global forex markets, I think the message is loud and clear. From the ruble to the Brazilian real, the Saudi real or the Mexican peso, the market is rushing for hard assets and punishing excessive cheap money. In the same way, US tech stocks and real estate in countries like Canada or Australia experience an unprecedented inflows from global investors craving to find a place to invest their money while we had the lowest rates ever. Now those same agents are starving for oil, gas, wheat, coffee or lumber. And those same suppliers are finding themselves swimming in cash after a decade of low commodity prices. In this new super bullish commodity cycle, the UK cannot be a winner, because it can't offer much of those commodities. But it is in their hand not to be a loser, but trying to eat the ice cream you cannot afford to pay. The competitive advantage of housing the global trade center of corporate finance and investment banking makes the use of the pound crucial in financial transactions. Combined with a global demand for education centers, an increase of demand for high-end manufacturing goods like Rolls-Royce aircraft turbines, and a comeback of the aviation industry using airports like Heathrow as their operation headquarters, could be leverage factors with enough strength to push the UK back into the top 5 biggest economies, and eventually boost a prominent recovery of the pound if demand picks up enough and energy bills don't get out of reach. Once again, the pound will only be saved if the numbers end up adding up and Downing Street doesn't spend what their math says you cannot pay for. If they stick to the current plan, economic theory says the sterling could very well see itself swimming in an ocean of volatility and pain. The Bank of England may manage to hold things up intervening forex markets. But if demand for pounds doesn't take up from abroad, even the powerful Bank of England may end up having a second Soros moment. We shall see what happens. In the end, I have no crystal ball. I am only an economist from Spain. I think it's time, and we'll end it here for now. Take care of yourselves and see you in the next one.